Welcome to Greeno's Family Garage, where quality repairs happen. It's going to be great, okay? Today we're going to change front disc brakes on 2006 Ford Fusion. Certainly, the procedures we use today can be used on many vehicles, but always check your manufacturer instructions. Now let's get started. Safety first. Wear your safety glasses, wear your gloves, always use manufacturer instructions. Always use manufacturer instructions on how and where to lift your vehicle. Make sure you always lift your vehicle on a strong, flat, level surface using jack stands, a floor jack, and leave the floor jack under the car for extra protection. You can even leave the tire under the unibody as well. And be sure to chalk your wheels, okay? Now, a couple things. Make sure you check your brake hoses and lines for cracks or deterioration while doing your brake job. Also, replace. Let's try to replace your pads and rotors in pairs. And very importantly, pump the brakes after you're done with the brake job. What do you mean? We will show you in the video, but you pump your brakes up after you're done to make sure you got a nice hard pedal before you start up and put it in drive. Otherwise, you're going to hurt somebody or you're going to wreck the car. Now, let's talk about a few best practices. Leave one side together as a reference. That way, if you forget how something goes on, you can reference a side you left together. Leave the key on the accessory position. This way you can turn the wheel back and forth. You can gain access behind it. After jacking the car up, take the tire and move it. Does it move easily? If it doesn't, you might have something wrong with your caliper or your brake lines. Always put a pad in front of the piston when collapsing it. This helps protect the piston and helps provide even pressure. Start all the bolts by hand, no cross-threading. Start them by hand, okay? Your pad with the squealer, if it's supplied, usually goes on the piston side. Reference the other side as to where it goes. Or reference, better yet, how you took it off. Remember, you can put one lug nut on the rotor to hold it in place before putting the brake caliper back on. It holds it straight, okay? Also, make sure the backing plate doesn't rub up against the rotor before putting the tire back on. You could have hit it, bent it, during your brake job, and all of a sudden you've got a noise, and where does it come from? Could be the backing plate. And always check the fluid level after pumping your brakes. Tools and supplies. Everybody loves tools and supplies, so I'm going to show you what I use. Anyways, this is what we're using during the repair. You'll need a repair specifications manual for your vehicle, gloves, safety glasses, copper anti-seize, brake grease, and silicone paste. Here's an example of small packets of brake grease that sometimes come with the brake pads or can be purchased separately. You're gonna need brake cleaner. You're gonna need brake fluid that matches the specifications of your car. You're gonna need blue medium strength thread locker. You're gonna need penetrating fluid. Now for lifting your car, refer to the manufacturer specifications and use wheel chocks, a floor jack on a smooth and level strong surface, and jack stands. Parts you'll need: you're going to need a brake hardware kit. You're going to need new brake pads and maybe even some new rotors. Hand tools are going to include half-inch drive protective socket for removing the lug nuts, an impact wrench, a half-inch extension, a half-inch drive ratchet with a 15mm socket, half-inch drive torque wrench, 3/8-inch drive ratchet, and 3/8-inch drive torque wrench, and 14mm sockets. You're going to need some screwdrivers, an impact driver, a T40 Torx bit, a brass hammer, a rubber hammer, and bungee cord. You're also going to need a pad depressor or a C-clamp, a rotor micrometer, various die grinder and attachments if you're going to do it like I do it, a garbage bag or fender cover, pedal depressor, bleeder bottle, clean funnel for brake fluid, 8mm ignition wrench, shop rags. Now, let's go straight to the repair.
If you could see what I got here, I got an impact socket. But it's thin wall, it's got a protective coating on the outside so it doesn't hurt your rim. It's also got some protection on the inside, you can see it there, the white plastic, that so it doesn't scrape your lug nuts. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the tire off, we're going to just use our impact gun here, and we're just going to take the tire off. And what I do as I take the lug nuts, I put them in one of these magnetic trays, and I have them right on the lift, so they're right there when I need them. Take the tire off. You can see the brakes there. You can see right down in here, there's much room from the backing plate to the rotor. So these are ready to be changed. You want to make sure you clean the cap and around it on your master cylinder so you don't get any contamination on the inside. So with this, we're going to open it up. And wow. It's almost bone dry. What you want to remember is you want to put the type of, I don't know if you can see it there, it says dot 3, let's see, right up in there, dot 3 fluid. You want to make sure you use the right fluid when you fill your master cylinder. Now, this master cylinder, you don't want to leave it uncapped for any period of time either. This master cylinder I'm doing the brake job on, normally I wouldn't fill it to the end, but it is down so far that I don't want a chance having to reprime that master cylinder. So we're going to take some brand new dot 3-4, it's dot 3 and dot 4 brake fluid, and we are going to put some in this master cylinder. Now, I don't know if you can see it, but I do have, you can see over on the side here, I don't know if you can see it, but over on the side I do have a, just use a trash bag to cover the car because brake fluid can eat the paint. So we don't want that to happen. And to be able to get to this, I'm going to use a funnel. And then nearby, I'm going to have that little rag so we don't drip anything anywhere. Now, I'm not going to fill it all the way, but I'm just going to get some in there so I don't have a chance of running the master cylinder dry. That's one of the worst things you could do. So there, we've got some in there. And I am not going to chance getting any of this on the car at all. Now, once you open brake fluid, you want to use it or get rid of it. So right now we're going to take and we're going to put this cap back on. Okay, we're going to put this cap back on and we are going to now start working on the brakes. We are not going to push the pistons back in and force the fluid back into the ABS system. So we really don't have to worry about taking that off or fluid coming back. And I'll show you how we're going to do that. But for now, let's go back to the brakes. I'll take this fender cover, which is just a piece of plastic, and set it to the side. Now we're going to jack the car back up. This is a 2006 Fusion. And one of the first things we're going to do, I'm just going to take a little bit of penetrating oil. I'm going to put it around the hat. I'm going to put a little bit in there in these lug holes there. Just a little bit. It'll help me get the rotor off. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a little around here, around these screws. And what they are is they're Torx bit screws. And we're going to have to take those out. Now, if you're up in the north, it's going to be a little harder. What I do, we'll see what size this is. I believe it's either a 30 or 40, probably a 40. Yeah, it's a T40. So what I'll do is I'll take my impact driver, and then I'm not talking your impact wrench. I'm going to take the impact driver that I hit with a hammer. Okay? Now, being down south, you can probably get it off, get these off, either by just twisting it, most likely not, but you might be able to get it off with a regular ratchet, 3/8 ratchet. But what I'm going to do in this case is I'm going to hit it with this impact driver, because that'll try to break it loose a lot quicker and easier. There we go. That one came loose. Yeah, what I do is I also twist in a counterclockwise motion. This one's being a little harder. But I think we got it. I think it started. Hit it with a little more penetrating oil. So you're going counterclockwise. There we go. There we go. So now we can just take these out, spin them out. These screws hold down the calipers and keep them straight during production. We'll put them back in. But that is good. We got them out. Now I'm going to clean that caliper a little bit. Especially get the dust off of there and the junk off of there. But you can see right here that's your bleeder screw, okay? And there's a little plastic, little rubber cover over that. Now that bleeder screw, we're gonna actually pop that open before we press the piston in. Now I'm going to show you how we're going to do that without getting air into the system. But we want to make sure that it's nice and clean around it before we open it up. We want to make sure we know the size. So I'm going to take this cap off and I am going to save the cap. And what I use a lot of times, I think this is 8 millimeter. Yeah, it is. Okay, that's 8 millimeter, and sometimes I'll use an ignition wrench because it allows me more room to be able to put a bleeder bottle on there. And that's exactly what we're gonna do. So I'm trying to give you a close-up so you can see. So this is a bleeder bottle. It has a rubber tube on the end of it. You can make one if you want to. You can just use some rubber tubing, and you can use a Coke bottle or some kind of plastic bottle. I've got these bleeder bottles that I bought, but you don't have to buy them, okay? You want the bottle to be lower. You want the bottle to be lower than the bleeder screw. So I'm just going to hang it like thus. And you can see the tube is nice and flexible, goes right over the bleeder. Okay, there. And then what we're going to be doing, we're going to be going counterclockwise to open it. Also, what I want to point out is, I'm not going to do it right now, otherwise I'm going to let air in it. So I'm going to show you what I do not to let air back into the system. So what I've got is I've got a pedal depressor. And you can see that the pedal depressor hooks up to the steering wheel, works like a caulking gun, and pushes on the brake pedal. Now what this does is it forces the master cylinder forward in its bore, so when you open the bleeder valve on the caliper, your brake fluid isn't going to go back up into the system, okay? It isn't going to go back up in your ABS system or in your master cylinder because we've effectively blocked off the port. So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to crack the bleeder to make sure that the bleeder's good and it's going to work. Okay? Because the last thing I want to do when I push the piston back in, I'm actually going to open up the bleeder. Some people just force the piston back in and the fluid goes back up through the fluid hoses. Then it gets into your ABS system. You don't want that to happen. ABS systems are expensive. Do you really want to chance it that you have garbage in that cylinder and you're going to push it back up? The other thing that people do is they'll take the brake hose here, and we'll see the brake hose later. We'll talk about the brake hose. But they'll pinch off the brake hose. They'll pinch it off, okay? And then they'll push the piston back in while opening the bleeder valve. That is not good for your brake hoses. Your brake hoses can be damaged on the inside and you don't even know it. And that's something we don't want to do. We don't want to cause injury or anything like that. So now with pressure on the brake pedal, with the tool that I showed you, we're just going to crack this open just to make sure that it opens. And there, it opened really quick. That's all I needed to do. Now we know it'll open. We didn't let any air in. And now we'll be able to take and push that piston back in and make sure that we force all the fluid out and into the fluid reservoir. So, the caliper is ready. Let's go on to the next step. Next thing we get to do is we get to take the two caliper bracket bolts off. You can see one there and one there. So you got two caliper bracket bolts and we've got to take them off. So you could use a ratchet with a 14 millimeter socket. What I use is I use my Milwaukee electric ratchet, battery powered actually. I love this thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to break them loose because they shouldn't be that tight on. There we go. And then I just go to the next one, break that loose. Okay, that's broken loose. I could just take them both out. That easy. Two bolts, two small ones. Put them in my tray so I have them. That's a 14 millimeter for the two caliper two bracket bolts. So it's what holds the caliper to the caliper bracket. So now what we have to do is we have to go back and release the brake pedal because the caliper won't come off unless the brake pedal is released. Remember, we put that special tool on it. Now what we're going to do is I'm going to take this brake caliper off. Okay, it should come off pretty easy. I've got the bungee cord in my hand. Then what I'm going to do, I've almost got it off here. It's coming. One of those little springs popped off. Watch, there's springs on those pads. I'm going to take my caliper and I'm going to make sure that it's supported. I'm going to make sure it's supported with a bungee cord because I don't want the caliper pulling. Somebody grease this up this way too much. I'm going to make sure that this isn't being pulled on, because if that's pulled on, you can damage. Now you can see these pads don't have much left on them at all, okay? And one thing I want you to look at is the holes that are in these pads. See the holes? Well, that's where these springs come in, okay? And the spring attaches in each hole to help keep the pads away from the rotor, okay? So you want to make sure you save them if you don't have new hardware, but I recommend that you have new hardware. Now we can take the brake pads themselves off. You can see that it's not totaled, but you're in time for some new pads. That's the outer one. And there's the inner one. You can see that it is getting time for new pads. So we got the pads off. Certainly you got the hardware. We have new hardware, so I'm not going to worry about any of that. The next thing we want to do is take off the caliper bracket. Okay? Okay, right here and right here. These are the caliper bracket to knuckle. This is a knuckle. Here's a caliper bracket. That's the bolts that holds the caliper bracket to the knuckle. We're going to take these two off. They're both 15 millimeter. I put a long ratchet on this to really make it easy to get off. Oh, and you really don't need, unless they're really on there hard, you can usually screw them out with your fingers, which is exactly what I'm going to do. Now your caliper bracket will come off. Be careful because your rotor will come off also. We're going to have to clean the bracket up. And we're going to set the bolts in the... I have a special tool that pushes the piston back in. What we're going to do is we're going to take the pad. This was the inner pad. We're going to put that in there. We're going to put the tool in there, and we're just going to push it just a tiny bit so it's got some pressure on there. This is being held up by the bungee cord. I'm going to go back and put the pedal depressor back on. Now the pedal depressor is back on the pedal. And what I'm going to do is hook up this bleeder bottle and this wrench. You just have to be very careful. We don't want to crimp the hoses, which we're not going to do. We're going to put that on the bleeder. So what I'm going to do now is remember, the fluid isn't going to go back up to the master cylinder. I'm going to start pressing on this like a caulking gun, which I really can't press that much now, until I open the bleeder. So I'm going to open the bleeder. Now you can see I've got the bleeder cracked. And if you can see the line, the fluid is going back into the bottle. It's not going into the master cylinder. It's not going back up to the ABS. Why? Because I blocked it off using the pedal depressor. So there's positive pressure on the back of that piston. And when I open it up, I'm putting pressure on the fluid to come out the bleeder. Does this take a little longer than the normal way? Sure. Just pushing it back up in, but I would say that you're going to get some of that old fluid out of there, top it off with some new fluid, which is a good thing, and we can test the brake fluid on this. Still a little ways to go. You want to keep some pressure on there. And this is how you do it without getting air in your system and without sending the fluid back up to the ABS. Now I tighten it off I can take this off now. There we go. Nice and neat, huh? That's the way to depress your piston without crimping and ruining the hose, the brake hose, and without forcing garbage back up into the system. Now what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to make sure that that's tight enough. You don't want it too tight. Yeah, it's fine. I'm going to take the pedal depressor off. Now, like I said, usually I would have had this all at one level and I'd just be doing blah, 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 back and forth, right? But I'm trying to put this thing up and down to be able to show you so you can see everything clearly. Now, what I would tell you to do at this point, so you don't forget it, is take your little rubber cap, the little rubber cap that goes on the bleeder screw. Let's put that back on, okay? Now that's on, we're not going to forget about it. All right, let's let the car back down. The pedal depressor is off. I have that ready for the other side. Usually I do two sides at the same time. Have two of these piston depressors right here, but I'm trying to show you one side at a time, okay? So this is all good. I'm gonna set this over here. It's all good. There's no pressure on this line. It's held by the bungee cord. This hub's actually in good shape. One of the things you wanna make sure that you do, this backing plate, you wanna make sure that when you're working on it that you don't accidentally pull it in, it'll rub against your rotor. Looks like there's some grease in there. So we're gonna hit this with some brake parts cleaner on this hub and try to clean it up a little bit. Which, it's actually in pretty good shape. I've dealt with a lot worse. A lot worse. I'm trying to get the grease off of there because I have special tools to come in. You want to make sure you're wearing safety glasses when you do all this, but I have special tools to come in and to clean this hub, even though it looks perfect now, right? But I'll show you what they are. And it won't hurt them. And I want to get this rust out of there anyways, much as I can. This is why I think the penetrating oil might have helped a little bit, but this hub being in this good a shape, I think that's why that rotor came off really, really easy. Matter of fact, just popped right off. So we're gonna get some air tools here. Now, I don't know if you know it or not, but rust can be one of the causes of lateral runout. Lateral runout is when you have your rotor like this, you're going down the road and it wobbles, okay? So here's the rotor, here's the mating surface on the inside of the rotor here. I clean both of those up when I do brake jobs. As the car rusts can build up and it can, and I'm going to over exaggerate, but rust can make the rotor pop out a little bit. And then that'll make that rotor go like this when you're going down the road and you feel pulsation. So I always do a good job of cleaning up the hub and the inside of the rotor, which that needs a little clean up too. It's just a regular die grinder, an angle die grinder, okay? And I have this attachment for it. And it's really nice, especially when they're rusty, because it goes right over the bolt like you see here. And you just go like that and it cleans around the bolt. Now, we don't have a situation where I need to clean all these, but it does a real nice job when there's rust on there. When there's rust on there, cleaning them up. The other tool I'll come in with, and I leave these right on their own die grinder, so I don't have to change die grinders all the time. The other tool I have is just a flat roll lock disc. And that's good for getting in between the studs. I also have a different assortment of wire brushes, and of course they're all on their own die grinder. And I have a bigger wheel that'll kind of get around and in between where the studs and the hub is. So that's cleaned off pretty good. That'll be nice. Then what we'll do is we'll put some copper anti-seize on the back of this when we put the rotor back on. And I'm going to put some copper anti-seize on this hub. Likelihood next time it'll be easy to get off because it was before, and you know, we're down here in the south where salt doesn't get all of it. But if for some reason this goes up north, I don't put anything on the studs. Do not lubricate the studs. I just put it in between the rotor. And the hub. That's all. Put a light coat. Don't have to be excessive. Something there to make it easy next time. It's all about making life easier, right? And yes, we'll put a little bit on the... We'll put a little bit on the screws that go into the rotor, into the hub, you know, with those Torx bits. We'll put a little on there, but that's it. That's about it. Just put some on there lightly. Okay, so what we're gonna do is clean up this caliper bracket. You want to make sure that you notice that these little tabs go on the outside, as you can see. Little tabs on the outside. Okay, we're just gonna clean it up a little bit. We just want to make sure there's no junk underneath where the... We just want to make sure that there's no debris underneath where the... We just want to make sure there's nothing underneath where the brake hardware is going to be. And then all the bosses are clean. Yes, we're going to take those pins out. I just want to make sure nothing's going to really interfere with them, and then it's clean before I do. So that looks halfway decent. That looks good. We're going to put a wire brush to these bosses really quick. It isn't going to be much. We're going to put the wire brush to that, and then we're gonna work on these pins here and make sure they're lubricated very well. Okay, we're gonna clean these up a little bit. That's all it takes. Just a little bit there. There we go. We just want that cleaned up where the hardware goes on. We can take our pins out. Now what I'm going to do is put these clips in. Really simple. Nice snap in the place like that. I don't know if you can see it good. Hopefully you can. Driver's side. The pads were wearing unevenly. So what we're going to do is we're going to put new caliper guide pins, new slide pins in here. Now, you got to be careful because there's two different size of guide pins. First thing I'm going to do before I put the guide pins in, first thing I'm going to do is put these little rubber boots on. Okay? I'm going to put the little rubber boots on. New rubber boots. So I already... I'll put the new rubber boots on. It's just a matter of... What I'm going to do is I'm going to put the new rubber boots on. Okay? I'm just going to slide that over. And that should go on. There we go. It's on all the way around. Okay, we got the rubber boots on. Now we have to take the rubber pieces. There's these small rubber pieces that go on the end of this shaft. Just like this one has them, you can see on the end. Okay, you can see that little black part right there. That's rubber that helps it slide, that helps it stay nice and straight in the bore. And then we're just going to put a little silicone paste on there and slide them over. Not too hard, right? Very easy. Okay. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take, make sure I have some paste, silicone paste going on the inside of that. Okay, and we can wipe off the excess. Then I'm gonna put a nice amount on the pin itself. Okay, put a nice amount on the pin. Now there's two different pins. There's a short pin and a long pin. Okay, the brass pin is a short pin. That goes down towards the bottom of the caliper. Okay? You might have to work that in a little bit. The top one goes near the bleeder valve. Okay, so that one's in. And this one's giving me a little bit of a problem, but we're not going to force anything. There it goes. You want to force it. Now I just have to pull up the boot to come over the top. There we go. So now you can see we have both new slide pins in. I like the way they move. Our hardware's on. Now that caliper bracket is ready. You want to remember on your caliper bracket, okay, that the longer pin goes to the top towards the bleeder and the shorter pin goes towards the bottom. Because there are two different length of pins their new ones in there because the pads were actually wearing uneven. So we put new pins in there. And we do have new rotors to put on.
There are four clips that you see circled in red. You want to make sure that the flat side of these clips are facing the rotor.
Okay, we got new rotors for the front. I took them out of the bag. It's got a coating on it called Cosmoline. And what that does is that keeps the rotor from rusting while it's in storage. So I already compared this to the other rotor, the original one that I got off the car, and it's the same. So you want to just check them to make sure that they're the same size, etc. Once you've done that, you need to clean the surfaces where the pads go. Okay, so I'll spray them and wipe the surfaces down. Flip it over. Spray it again. This gets all that Cosmoline off there so we can put the rotor on. And again, I'm going to hit it once more just to make sure. Notice I'm not touching the surface of the rotor with my hands. Of course, I can clean it again, but you just really don't want to get any grease or anything you may have on your hands on that surface. So now it's nice and clean. I'm going to put it right on the car. Okay, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put the screws in to hold on the rotors. And I'm going to take a little bit of copper anti-seize so it'll come out easier next time. And I'm just going to push that on, get it started. It's started, I'll go to the next one. Again, a little dab will do ya, a little dab of anti-seize. It's always good. A little lube. Okay, put that on. Now, I can take the impact driver here and just screw that right on. Same thing here. And what I'll do, I'll give it a couple hits with a hammer. So we've got anti-seize in there, a couple hits. Right here you can see the two bosses where the caliper bracket goes to the knuckle. We've got a torque wrench set to 66 foot-pounds. Got a torque wrench set to 66 foot-pounds, and what we're going to do is we're going to take this bolt here and we're going to put some blue Loctite on it for the caliper to the knuckle. The reason we do that is so that the caliper bracket doesn't come off. Last thing you want to be doing is riding down the road and have your caliper fall off. How many garages don't do that? So what I do is I take and I'll put that in, start threading it. I'm Very good. Take the other bolt, do the same thing, put some Loctite on it. This bottle's almost done. Yeah, I know, I put enough on, right? Hey, cheap insurance, right? Those guys that don't put, or gals that don't put Loctite on it, you're wrong. You are definitely wrong. And people that don't torque things are definitely wrong. I looked up the torque specs. I got my torque wrench set, 15 millimeter socket, and I'm gonna torque it to 66 foot-pounds, okay? Because I don't want this coming off. Always good to double check it. I'm going to spray this down once more. Now it's time for the brake pads. So with the brake pads, what I like to do is I like to put a little copper anti-seize on these ends here. Just a little bit. You don't have to get too wild with it. You don't want it on the brake system. You don't want it on the pads. So then I will take and try to get the top in first. Then work to the bottom, top, I'll go to the bottom, and that brake pad's in, and I'll do the same on the back. It does come with grease. You can use the grease on those parts, those little nubs on the pads. I'm just going to coat them with anti-seize, just a little bit. A little dab will do you, right? Don't get crazy with it. I heard people say, oh yeah, grease it up real good. Yeah, that's just what you want to do with your brakes. Listen, you want the proper lubrication in the proper spots. You also don't want to overdo it. So I'm going to go around to the back. Fortunately for me, I can see this on my lift. It's a lot easier. Okay. Now I'm working on the bottom. Check it all out, and they're in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the grease that they did give me. I'm going to put it on some on the back of the pads. And I'm just going to put it on there. On the back of the pads, on both sides. It'll help stop vibration. Notice I'm not going crazy with it again. Just a nice light coat. On the back, it's mainly where the piston is. But it's just a nice light coat. There's not a lot on there, just enough to lubricate it. So we got the caliper hanging up still. We've got the pads greased. And what we've got to do is we've got to put the springs on these brake pads. We have to put the springs on the brake pads and then the caliper over the pads. So first thing we're going to do is squeeze these springs, put them in the holes, hold the brake pads. I'm going to get the caliper off of the bungee cord, slide it over, and we're good. Sometimes you might have to push these pistons, not these pistons, these slide pins. You might have to push them in, but it's all good now. So I'm going to take the bungee cord off, make sure that we don't have the bungee cord hanging around, okay? We'll take our new bolts for the caliper, and we'll put them in. They're 14 millimeter. There we go. Okay, we got those in. Run those up. They keep twisting on you. It's a 17 millimeter up here. You may or may not be able to get to it, but your wrench may be a little too thick, such as mine, but it's holding it. Okay. I just run them down for speed like that with my hands. Or use my battery charged ratchet, but we've got the torque wrench with a 14 millimeter socket, 20 foot-pounds. We got the torque wrench with a 14 millimeter socket at 20 foot-pounds. Doesn't take much. I'm gonna do the top too. If you can see the bolts that I'm torquing on. There's caliper bracket bolts. There's one here. There's one up here. They're the caliper slide pin bolts. Caliper bolts to the slide pins. 20 pounds. Always want to make sure everything's torqued. So now that wheel is basically ready to go, we have everything, you know, just want to check it over. The rotors are clean. Everything's torqued correctly. Probably the last thing I've got to do is I just noticed this little rubber piece that goes on the brake leader. Looks like it may need a new one. We'll put that on before we put the tire back on. Okay, I've got a new rubber seal, a rubber cap for the bleeder. So we want to make sure that we put that on there. Nice. I want the car to go out of my shop with it being all set. When we're all done, we're going to check the brake fluid level. You want to make sure you do that, especially when you're doing all your wheels. Make sure at the end it's between the min and the max, up towards the max when you've got all new brake pads on there. And then leave it there as you go, and if it goes down too far, it'll tell you you have a problem, like you need new brake pads. So, I've got my Milwaukee. I've got two settings on it. One that's basically 100 foot-pounds. But I'm not going to put these on all the way. I'm just going to tighten them just a little bit to make it fast. We'll lower the car to the ground, and then we'll torque the lug nuts with the torque wrench. Car's on the ground now. Torque specifications for a 2006 Ford Fusion is 98 foot-pounds. So I'm going to set my torque wrench to 98 foot-pounds. And then what we'll do, and I've got the special socket on there that's protected on the inside to protect the head of the lug nut. Also, on the sides, it's plastic to protect the rim. So what I'll do is I'll simply go in a star pattern, tightening them down. And I haven't gotten near the torque spec yet. Didn't expect to. Now I'll go to the torque spec. I'm still going in the star pattern, alternating. Okay. Let's just check them all. And that's good.
Now that was long, wasn't it? But I did it because I wanted all the details left in it for you. So what I ask you to do is please like, please subscribe, and please leave your comments below. Thanks for watching Greeno's Family Garage, where quality repairs happen. We'll see you later.